We're here at Pikes Peak International Hill Climb with the LYFE Motorsport R35 GTR. Now this car should be reasonably familiar to anyone who's been following Global Time Attack or also World Time Attack Challenge. And we took the opportunity here during the setup day to give you guys a quick tech tour of the car to find out a little bit more about what makes it tick. Now, we've actually followed this car around the world a couple of times now. We've seen it both in Sydney at World Time Attack Challenge as well as here at Pikes Peak. And unfortunately, both times we've seen the car, the team have suffered some really bad luck with some engine failures. Now this time around, during early testing for Pikes Peak, Cole was driving the car and it suffered from a crankshaft failure. Now this didn't really give the team very much time to get the car back up and running, and unfortunately they were also restricted in what they could do. Normally they run a custom crankshaft that produces a 4-litre engine from the base 3.8-litre Nissan VR38. They weren't able to source another custom crank in time, so they had no option but to fit a stock production crankshaft. The problem with this is the production crankshaft has a shorter stroke, and while they were stuck with the aftermarket pistons and conrods that they were running for the 4-litre crankshaft, this means that the pistons now sit a long way down from the top of the bore at top dead centre. This has the effect of severely reducing the compression ratio of the engine. So unfortunately, while it's not an ideal solution, the team have worked around the clock, including Phil Laird from Australia, who worked overnight to build the new VR38 engine so that they could make it to the start line for the race tomorrow morning. Now let's start with a quick rundown on the car. We've already discussed the engine, and what I'll go over is what the original 4-litre engine that the team normally run consists of. Now this is the same engine that Cole was using when he famously beat HKS in the Speedring event in 2016. The engine consists of the custom stroker crank that I've already mentioned, as well as a set of Carrillo H-beam conrods and a set of custom CP pistons that in the 4-litre engine produce a compression ratio of around 10.5 to 1. That's a relatively high compression ratio, but that works really well with the E85 fuel that the team use. On the intake side to the engine, it's fitted with an AMS intake manifold. Now this intake manifold is a bit of a work of art. The base of the manifold as well as the runners are CNC machined from aluminium. In this case they've been anodized red, and then it runs into a pair of custom carbon fiber manufactured plenum chambers. These still mount the factory Nissan drive-by-wire throttle bodies. Now one of the keys with the AMS intake manifold is it allows for two sets of injectors to be fitted, and this becomes essential once we start running very high power levels out of these Nissan VR38 engines. The primary injectors are a set of Injector Dynamics ID1700s, while the secondary injectors are a set of ID1000s. Now these are all controlled through the ECU, and what happens is that at low loads and low engine speeds only the primary injectors are used. However, as the boost and RPM is increased, the secondary injectors are staged in by the ECU. This all happens seamlessly, and there's no change in the air fuel ratio, and it's impossible to feel when those secondary injectors are staged in. One of the keys to making power out of the Nissan VR38 engine is the turbocharger selection, and in this case LYFE Motorsport are using an AMS kit which consists of custom AMS exhaust manifolds with turbo smart 45mm external wastegates, and the turbochargers themselves are a Garrett Gen 2 GTX 3076. Depending on the conditions and the event, the driver has the ability to adjust the boost from a low boost of 15 psi above atmospheric pressure all the way through to 26 or 27 psi. Now, this is key, of course, at an event like Pikes Peak where we're battling against low barometric air pressure, and this tends to strangle the engines and makes it much harder for the engines to make power in the first place. In terms of the power the engine is able to produce, on high boost, as it was run at the speed ring event where it beat HKS, the engine was producing around about 1200 horsepower. Cooling an engine that's producing this sort of power is obviously a critical aspect, and the team have addressed this really thoroughly, and in fact they've made some specific changes purely for the Pikes Peak event, because the low air density at Pikes Peak not only affects the amount of power that the engine produces, but it also reduces the efficiency of the cooling system. And this goes for the intercooler as well as the radiator for the engine itself and the oil coolers cooling the engine oil. Starting with the radiator, there's a large front-mounted radiator, and this is the sole radiator system the car uses during normal time attack type racing. For Pikes Peak racing, the team have fitted an extra two radiators in the rear of the car, and this means that the cooling capacity has increased to a massive 9 gallons. So this is going to help control the engine temperature as the car runs for approximately 10 minutes under high load from the start to the 14,000 foot summit. Not only do we need to worry about the actual coolant temperature, it's also vital to get rid of the heat out of the engine oil, and this is dealt with in a couple of ways. At the front of the engine bay, there's a Laminova water to oil heat exchanger, but there's also a pair of Set-Trab oil to air heat exchangers or oil coolers mounted on each side of the front bumper. Those oil to air heat exchangers also mounted right beside the two air-to-air intercoolers, one for each turbocharger. Making huge horsepower is one thing, but it's also critical to get it to the ground and make sure that you can get it to the ground reliably. Now, the R35 platform is already a four-wheel drive car, so that's obviously an advantage, and it's fitted with a six-speed dual-clutch transaxle, which is mounted in the rear of the car. Now, this provides some advantages, but also some disadvantages or challenges for those who are making high horsepower levels. Certainly at the 1200 horsepower level, the factory dual-clutch transmission has proven to be weak, and LYFE Motorsport have gone through and fitted a full Dodson Motorsport upgrade kit to the transmission, making sure that it's capable of reliably handling the power and the abuse that's being dished out to it. Now, the electronic control aspects of this dual clutch transmission are another area that become a little bit challenging. The transmission has its own electronic control module, which is the factory Nissan module. Now, this has been modified in its tuning via the EcuTek tuning software, and this is used to change aspects such as the RPM that the shifts will be accomplished at. It's important though for seamless use and reliability that the transmission control module also receives and sends the correct signals to the ECU in charge of controlling the engine. And in this case, the team are using a full accompaniment of MoTeC product, and the engine control itself is handled by a MoTeC M150 ECU running the R35 GTR package. Now, this runs the engine much like you'd expect from any aftermarket engine manager system. However, the interesting part is the interaction between the engine control unit and the transmission control unit. What the MoTeC ECU does is constantly calculates the amount of torque that the engine is producing, and this value is then sent via CAN to the Nissan transmission control module. Now, when the driver selects an upshift using the paddles mounted behind the steering wheel, what happens is that the transmission control module sends a signal back to the MoTeC ECU requesting that the torque is reduced so that the next gear can be engaged. Now, this is critical because if the torque is not reduced correctly, then this can result in damage to the clutches and the dual clutch transmission. Once the MoTeC ECU receives this request for an upshift, what it does is it reduces the engine torque via either ignition retard or ignition cut or a combination of both of those. Once the transmission control module knows that the torque has been reduced, the next gear can be engaged, and one of the advantages of the dual clutch transmission is that these shifts are lightning fast because the next gear is actually already engaged. All that needs to happen is that the clutch for the low gear is disengaged and the clutch for the higher gear becomes engaged. On a downshift, things are a little bit different, and what needs to happen is that the engine RPM is revved up or increased to match what the RPM should be for the lower gear. Again, this is all done using computer control. The transmission control module will send a signal to the ECU, and in this case, the MoTeC ECU can automatically blip the throttle to match revs using the drive-by-wire throttle bodies. This means that the driver can concentrate solely on keeping his hands on the wheel and driving the car, there's no need to use a clutch, and in fact these cars don't have a clutch pedal. This adds up to more control of the car during acceleration and braking, and this is one of the reasons why these cars prove to be such a fast package for motorsport use. As well as the MoTeC ECU, a MoTeC C127 dash logger is also fitted, and this serves as both a driver display as well as a logging hub. Now, one of the advantages with the C127 dash logger is it's monitoring all of the channels that are being sent into it, both directly as well as from the ECU via CAN. And the tuner can set up warnings for the driver. So if any of the parameters such as water temperature, oil temperature, or oil pressure go outside the bounds that the tuner is happy with, this can alert the driver to the situation via an alarm. Now, the advantage of this is that the driver can concentrate solely on driving the car until there's a problem. There's no need to scan gauges and make sure that everything's performing as you'd expect. As soon as there is a problem, a warning light will shine on the dash to bring the driver's attention to the fact there is a problem, and then the driver can simply glance at the dash and a message will display what that particular problem is. The last of the MoTeC products that we'll discuss is the MoTeC Power Distribution Module, or PDM. Now, this eliminates the need for any relays or fuses, and it uses solid state relays to control the power distribution through the various electronic modules and circuits inside the car. Now, while we've discussed the powertrain fitted to the car, that's obviously only one part of the puzzle to produce a fast and competitive race car. The other aspects that are important are the aerodynamic package as well as the suspension package. Now, in terms of the aerodynamic package, we can see that the aerodynamics on the car are visually pretty wild. Andrew Brilliant from AMB in Australia has been involved with the aero package on the car, and this produces obviously a huge amount of downforce, which becomes essential with these cars producing such high power levels. In terms of the suspension setup, this includes a complete custom setup from WiseFab, including custom billet uprights on the front of the car, as well as custom arms both front and rear. These are accompanied by a set of Olin's custom coilovers front and rear. These coilovers are also fitted with linear travel sensors, which are logged into the MoTeC dash, and this allows the suspension setup to be fine-tuned and optimized based on what it's doing on the racetrack and the conditions of that track. If there was a downside to the R35 platform, that would certainly be its weight. And while LYFE Motorsport have gone to some extreme lengths to reduce this weight, including producing a lot of the panel work out of carbon fibre, certainly the addition of the extra cooling for the Pikes Peak event hasn't helped. And this car currently weighs in at 3,700 pounds, or approximately 1,700 kilograms. Now, that certainly makes life a lot more difficult, and it also puts a lot more stress into the braking department. Now, in this case, the front brakes, which do the majority of the work, have seen a large upgrade. We've got a set of Brembo rotors and calipers, which are the same that are fitted to the R35 GT3 race car. The rear, on the other hand, has retained the factory calipers, and these are just fitted with uprated pads, which have proved to be sufficient. One other aspect that's really important to ensure reliability in a race car that's able to pull very, very high lateral G-force in corners is to ensure that the lubrication system to the engine is sufficient. Now, in this case, the factory wet sump system is seldom going to be up to the task, and LYFE Motorsport have again chosen to go for the top shelf products here, fitting a full dry sump system. What this does is uses an external oil pump to evacuate oil out of the crankcase, and it pumps it back to a remote mounted oil reservoir. An extra stage of that dry sump pump then pulls the oil from the dry sump reservoir and then pumps it through the engine. The design of the dry sump oil reservoir is of a tall cylinder with the pickup at the bottom. Now, this means that regardless of the loads being applied to the car, be it from cornering, accelerating, or braking, there's always a constant supply of oil available at the pickup. Now, an extra stage of the dry sump pump fitted to the engine draws that oil forward from the reservoir and then pumps it through the engine, and this ensures a constant supply of oil and ensures reliability of the bearings as well as the valve train and the turbochargers. While it hasn't been the ideal run-up to Pikes Peak International Hill Climb for 2017 for Cole and the LYFE Motorsport team, Cole is no stranger to this hill, and he's definitely no stranger to his R35 GTR. So we're looking forward to seeing how he goes in tomorrow's hill climb, and we wish him and the team all the best.